What else that you want to show us?
So I'd love to show you a couple of other things. We've been doing a lot of work with the debugger recently. So I don't know if you've ever had that situation where your code is littered with lots of breakpoints, and you may decide how to manage your breakpoints. We've had the breakpoint window for a while. The breakpoint window lets you switch on and switch off breakpoints that might exist. You can kind of manage that in some kind of way there. However, we've kind of been introducing not only ways to better manage your breakpoints, but also ways in which you can ignore them temporarily. Because sometimes a breakpoint just get in the way of your debugging. They're helpful once you kind of got up and running, but sometimes you actually just want to kind of ignore them for a while. So I've just started debugging this particular project, and it should in a moment hit the line 43. And I'm going to sit and wait for that. And so it's hit line 43. And I might say to myself, I just want to get all the way down to here. I don't want to have to hit. See, I'm trying to make sure people save as many keystrokes as possible. You only have so many in a given day, right? So I want to save as many keystrokes for you as possible. So I want to hit, I want to get down to here without having to hit break, you know, the continue button multiple times. And if I were to hit the normal force to run, it would actually stop at the next breakpoint. Mm-hmm. But I actually want to kind of go past that. So I'm going to zoom in here, and it would probably just stop at the next breakpoint. But if I hit the shift, you will see it change the icon, the glyph a little bit, and it says force run to execution. And that will basically mean I'm going to ignore all of the breakpoints up until that point and just sit here at that particular line. And as you can see, I've completely gone past all the breakpoints that there. I didn't have to delete my breakpoints or disable my breakpoints. I can completely get around that. And again, these debugging steps are going to kind of just save you time. These micro kind of frictions to getting things done, we're trying to make sure we kind of smooth those out for you as you kind of develop code. So that's one way you could definitely do that, is by kind of skipping around breakpoints using our new shortcuts here. So I'm going to hit continue. And I'm actually, I'm going to go ahead and disable these breakpoints. I want to show a few other types of breakpoints, if that's okay with you.
Yeah.
So let me zoom back out so you can see a little bit more context here. So what I actually want to also do here is kind of introduce a couple of other different types of breakpoints you can now use. So actually, we have a thing called, I'm right-clicking in the gutter here, and you'll see we have what is referred to as a conditional breakpoint. We've had those for a while, but they've kind of been a bit difficult to find, but that puts that front and center. The two I'm really, really interested in showing you today, though, is the temporary breakpoint and the dependent breakpoint. So a temporary breakpoint is exactly what it sounds like, right? You only hit it once. So I'm going to go ahead and navigate to the code. And it just went and hit that breakpoint. And as you can see, the glyph for them is gone, because it's already hit it just once. So again, those times when you're checking startup and you know you only need to do this once and you need to get into your debugging, these breakpoints will disappear and clean up for you immediately as you're finished. So again, think about those scenarios where you've kind of set these breakpoints all over the place and now you have to manage which ones to get rid of exactly. You can decide whether you want that breakpoint there or not. Secondly, there's another kind of breakpoint I want to make sure you're aware of, called dependent. So now I can say, I can right-click again and do an insert a dependent breakpoint. And this time it's saying, well, I only want to enable this one if you in fact hit the one before this. So now I can have breakpoints based on other breakpoints, rather than simply say, just go ahead and hit based on some condition. Maybe the condition's good, but also sometimes if I chose to stop at a previous breakpoint, I want to stop at this breakpoint. So now I have conditional breakpoints and temporary breakpoints as a mechanism for speeding up my debugging and diagnostics process.
So you don't even need to have a if statement. That's what I was doing before. I was adding an if statement in my stuff, saying, oh, like when it's the name is equal mark, then go there, right? And having some breakpoints. So now like I can manage that directly from the breakpoint. That's
exactly
awesome.
That's exactly it. So now I could have really complicated conditions that precede that, and only if it hits that one will it a second one. So I'm going to go ahead and I just refreshed. Just went ahead and refreshed the site, hit the first breakpoint, and it's hit the first breakpoint. And because it's hit the first breakpoint, I can simply hit continue and hit the second one. Mine's running a little bit slow. I think our meeting is eating up a little bit of my CPU here. But you can see that I can set up these conditional breakpoints. I can set up dependent breakpoints, and I can set these temporary breakpoints. All of these are really ways to kind of alleviate the pain we sometimes feel of managing our debugging session. I think you'll love it.
Wonderful. I'm really looking forward. But now you know what we will do? We'll look at the question that the audience have for us.